Hi, Greg.
Hey, Liz. How are you?
Good, thanks. You cover the airline industry for our investment banking division, and certainly this has been one of the hardest hit by the pandemic. Just to start, can you give us a sense of the scale of this crisis for the airline industry?
Yeah, the airline industry has unfortunately had a long history of multiple severe shocks to the system, from the first Gulf War after deregulation in the early 90s to 9/11 to SARS, global financial crisis. COVID-19 by far has been the worst stress our global industry has ever faced because it has been a global stress on the system. Top line revenue has fallen 50 to 75% across the globe. And the airlines, without a massive stimulus and aid package from governments around the world and a very, very healthy dose of help from the global capital markets, would be in very, very bad shape. So order of magnitude, this is the worst stress the airline sector, which is a sector that's seen a lot of stress in the past. It's the worst stress they've ever seen. Order of magnitude, it's 75% revenue top line degradation from the year before. So it has been, an existential crisis for a lot of our C-suite clients in the sector.
So just given the extreme challenges to the airline business, what are they doing to ensure that they have enough liquidity?
So there's really three things that every airline, C-suite and board have been doing. First, very detailed analysis of what's happening to the top line, and no one has a crystal ball, but trying to figure out areas where they can generate some cash flow. There is still demand. For example, even now there's still some demand in some leisure markets. So they're doing a very deep dive on their operating cash flow model, right? And the purpose of that is to figure out how much cash burn, so negative cash flow, are they going to be able to sustain for X number of months? So what they don't know and what no one knows is how long is X? So we don't have a crystal ball, but trying to create a stress environment and an analysis for the board where they can say over 6 months, 12 months, maybe even 18 months, we have this kind of cash burn rate. So that's the first thing. Second thing is working closely with their stakeholders in the government. Now, that's everything from the Hong Kong government helping Cathay Pacific to the German government helping Lufthansa. Of course, the US government through the CARES Act has been extremely constructive in helping the airline industry in the US, which employs hundreds of thousands of employees. So the second thing has been working with government to figure out a way in which government aid through payroll support or loans and grants can be helpful. And the third thing has been what they can be doing for their own purposes in the capital markets. And that's where Goldman's been able to work closely with our clients to help them with our balance sheet and with our help in accessing the capital markets.
So what kinds of deals are you seeing?
So we have been able to access different kinds of markets for our clients. And it depends on the jurisdiction. So the kinds of deals that we've been able to do from a very large rescue financing for Cathay Pacific in Hong Kong, which was comprised of preferred stock and rights issuance of common stock to existing shareholders, to what was announced at the end of July for British Airways and their parent company IAG, which was a very large $3 billion plus equivalent rights offering of common stock, to the US markets, where we've seen a variety of everything from high yield debt, both secured and unsecured, common stock offerings. American Airlines and United Airlines have done that. Convertible bond offerings, which a number of our clients have done. And then very interestingly, we've seen a couple of innovative transactions where United Airlines, for example, and currently Delta's in the market for something similar, have been able to access their frequent flyer and loyalty programs as very strong assets on their balance sheet that they can use as collateral to generate very attractive capital markets offerings. We've also seen things like American Airlines working with Goldman's Merchant Bank using intellectual property, so the value of the American Airlines brand, logo, website, domain, intangible assets, but clearly very, very valuable assets as collateral, in addition to infrastructure assets like the slots, routes, and gates that they're allowed to have to fly from one airport to another. These are rights that are granted by the FAA. So those kinds of intangible assets as collateral enabled American to do a really interesting, successful transaction with our merchant bank for $1.2 billion announced earlier this summer.
And what's been the reaction from investors to these types of financings?
As we've seen across the globe, the capital markets have been extremely constructive for a lot of different sectors, including those sectors really hit hard, like COVID-19, sectors like American Airlines, United Airlines, the cruise line companies. So they have been constructive in general, but they are still being picky. So we have seen some examples. One of our clients attempted to do a very large $2 billion aircraft-backed high-yield bond back in May. We were not involved in that transaction, and that deal was an example, rare example, but an example of the market saying, we don't want to do this. And that airline was unsuccessful in getting that deal done, had to pull the transaction at a very wide level. They later came back and did other successful transactions. So the markets are open and constructive, but they're not saying yes to everything. And some deals are getting done with more ease than others. But in general, I think the airline sector is viewed as a really important public utility. So investors think science, vaccine, testing, eventual recovery of demand, all of those things are going to happen at some point. Choosing management teams and choosing franchises that they're going to back is part of what investors do. And so far, knock on wood, we have seen pretty strong investor demand. Of course, they want the right pricing for the risk that they're taking, but the markets have been pretty constructive.
But even with investor interest in the innovative ways that airlines are tapping into the capital markets, we've still seen over the last few weeks, a number of airlines announce more layoffs and cutbacks on flights. Just given that, what's your short-term outlook for the airline industry?
So I think it's very different across the globe. I think domestic and short-haul travel will pick up more quickly. We're seeing strength in some markets. For example, domestic airline traffic in China is back to 70-80% of where it was pre-COVID. International traffic in China and Asia still is quite slow. We're seeing some green shoots. JetBlue announced a pickup in some of their short-haul and domestic traffic demand. That's great. Europe, we're seeing some continental Europe short-haul demand coming back. In general, across the globe, we think first we'll see leisure, then we'll see short-haul, then we'll see some business domestic, and then maybe eventually the last thing that we expect to see as recovery is international business. So slow ramp back up, but it does feel like there is a big pent-up demand to travel. And I think in general, passengers and business travelers are looking for the safety cues, either from the CDC or their own perceptions of successful testing mechanisms to do so.
So Greg, just looking down the road and a return to hopefully some semblance of normalcy, what do you think the future of air travel will look like?
I think that we will see more mask wearing even after the requirement for masks is dropped. So interestingly, in Asia, there was a lot more mask wearing pre-COVID. A lot of that developed after SARS, which was a terrible pandemic back in 2003, 2004. So I think you might start to see more of a culture of HEPA filtration for air, which many airlines and aircraft already utilize. You'll see more mask wearing. You'll see better hygiene conventions used in terms of cleaning and sanitation. So I think you'll see a lot of that stuff, which probably we'll see in everyday life as well. I think you'll see a pretty rapid adaption by airports for the ability to do rapid testing and for social distancing. So even once things return to normal, my airline clients are saying things are going to change in terms of the travel experience. And number two, they also expect that the overall shape of the industry is going to take a couple of years. The CEO of Delta, for example, predicted that we weren't going to see 2019 levels of traffic until maybe 2022, 2023.
Thanks, Greg.
Thank you.